Robbie, and welcome to Dark DJ Productions. And today we're going to be having a look at a very anticipated locomotive for Train Simulator 2020. This is the Southern Railway Bullied Rebuilt Merchant Navy Class by Bossman Games. Now, this has just been released, so I already know that I've done a Dark Tries as such, aka the Dark Previews this week, but we're going to have another go, and today we're going to have a look at the Merchant Navies. So, I'm going to have a look around at the model, I'm going to have a look around at the liveries that are included in the pack and what's included, and I'm going to go for a little test drive. So, I'm going to do what I usually do and start off with a small bit of history. I've not read all this, I've not written this all up, I'm going by, you know, the general history of the class. So, what are the Merchant Navies and why were they rebuilt, you may ask? Well, the Merchant Navies were designed by Oliver Bully for the Southern Railway, and they were built during wartime, and they had lots of very odd novel features and lots of things with them that some people might find a bit bizarre. For example, they were built with the bullied Firth Brown wheels that you can see here, and they were also built in a more square shape, you know, the air-smoothed casing, similar to what some of the West Countries and Battle of Britain's have been preserved like. As you can see, though, every member of the class were rebuilt by British Railways in their later lives. But the thing about the Merchant Navies as they originally were built was they were built for wartime work, and they were actually classed as mixed traffic locomotives when built. This is a bit cheeky by the Southern Railway, but it was the only way that Bullied could get his locomotive built during the war, and it had to prove itself by pulling freight trains as well. But obviously, after the war ended, these locomotives all passed into British Railways ownership, and they were clearly given passenger engine clarification. So, the Merchant Navies continued in their original shape with the, you know, air smooth casing and the chain-driven valve gear, which was a very weird, complicated way of building valve gear in the war. They were all rebuilt, though, when British Railways decided that instead of scrapping the whole class, they were going to rebuild them more along the lines of the BR Standard class, which is why they have a very BR Standard class look to them. So they all passed into this rebuild state, and then, unfortunately, they lasted all the way up till the end of Southern Steam and were, unfortunately, all sent for scrap, except for Clan Line, which was preserved and runs on the main line nowadays. But several have been saved from scrapyards, so most of them have come from Barry Scrapyard. And of the 30 preserved, there's, I think, something like 11 preserved. Of the 30 built, there's 11 preserved or something like that. And they're all in various states. You know, for example, you've obviously got Clan Line, which is a mainline performer. We've had engines operate in the past, like Port Line, which is no longer operational. We've got new engines coming out that have been under overhaul for a very long time and under repair, such as Peninsula and Oriental Steam Navigation Company and British India Line, which has a very hard, funny joke livery included in the pack when it ran for the first time in preservation. So, what do you get with the Merchant Navy pack that I'm showing you right now? Well, what you get is all 30 members of the class. So from this one, which is the very first one, channel packet, all the way up to the final one, which was 35030, you've got lots of liveries. So you've got weathered variants, you've got the clean variant, you've got early and late crested tenders, you've got lots of variations on the tender as well, because there's something like 6 different variants of the tender, depending on what water capacity it had. So really, even from that standpoint, you look at the Merchant Navy class that has been represented by Bossman Games, you get a lot for your money. You get a lot in this pack. You know, you've got the absolutely stunning modelling, as you can see here. I mean, it looks incredible. Like, we're just going to have a scooch around this one. You can see the blue one in the background. We're going to have a look at that one properly in a minute. But yeah, you know, you look at this, and I know I have to fanboy slightly over anything Southern, but apart from a small few things that I've noticed, I'm very impressed overall with the pack. Got to say that I'm slightly disappointed with some other bits of it, but overall, you know, as a pack for Train Simulator, this is very, very good. You know, it's of really high standard. So, you know, we're just panning along the engine. You can really feel the presence of a Merchant Navy here and how big they are, actually, because obviously these things were probably one of the biggest locomotives built by the Southern Railway. So, and you can see all the intricate pipework, you can see the rivets, and you can see all the other little details underneath. It's also got some very good animations and things, such as opening damper doors, and opening vents and all that. You can see here that the livery's been very well applied, even though I have to point out that I've noticed if you go right up close to it, the livery can sometimes get a little bit blurry, and my cam work can get a bit juddery, as it just did there. But, you know, overall, I mean, look at it. Like, it just looks fantastic. It has such a presence. I hate to be that sort of guy, and I know that I sound like I'm very sucky-uppy, but, you know, being a southern person, really liking the real-life Merchant Navies anyway, you know, I'm very impressed. And I think the pack was made in conjunction with the Merchant Navy Locomotive Preservation Society. I hope I got that right. So, you know, you can tell how much Bochman Games has gone to the effort to bring the Merchant Navies into Train Simulator. So, we're going to have another look around at all the liveries we've got. So, as you can see here, this is the clean livery. And as you can see, they have the early British Railways logo. Now, the Merchant Navies were rebuilt from when that crest was in operation. So, they were rebuilt from, like, I think it was something like 1954 or 1955, possibly 1956. So, mid-50s, these were rebuilt. So, some of the ones that were rebuilt the earliest ended up still having the early crest on the tenders, which is why they've been included. Now, a lot of people know that the West Countries and Battle of Britons, some of those were rebuilt too, but they only carried late crest. So that's really impressive to have the early crest on a rebuilt locomotive tender. So, you know, I think that's pretty impressive considering. So as you can see, looking around the front as well, something else I want to mention about the modelling before we carry on to the other logos is that you've got the headlights work, and so do all the disc classification. So you can put your own combination of discs on the front of the locomotive. As well as you probably saw in the background a moment ago, a big variety of headboards as well, which I'll get to when I go and drive my locomotive in a minute. So, you know, just looking more at the detail of the livery and looking at the valve gear, it looks very impressive. You know, it's probably some of the best modelling in Train Simulator. Very much up there in terms of quality, and it just, you know, still has that really beefy presence. The other thing I want to mention as well, which is quite nice, and as you'll see in a moment on the weathered variants at least, is you can run the Merchant Navies without their nameplates, as they would have run at the end of British Railways. So really, you can drive the Merchant Navy throughout their entire lifetime in more or less accurate liveries and representation. So, you know, if you want to drive, say, I don't know, let's say Elder Fife's, and you want to drive that one in weathered livery with no nameplates, you can. If you want to drive one of them in the blue livery that was only applied to Canadian Pacific in preservation, because these weren't rebuilt at the beginning of British Railways when the blue livery was there, you can. So, you know, absolutely fantastic. You can do a lot with this pack. So, as you can see here, we're just about to come and have a look at the weathered variant, and on this locomotive we've put the Night Ferry headboard on. And, you know, as you can see from the weathering here, and you can also tell that it's got no nameplate too. You can see that it looks very grimy, and this is how they would have looked at the end of steam on British Railways. At the end of steam in 1966 on the southern region. And as you can see here, just moving the camera up slightly, you can see the design of the tender. Sorry about my camera being all wobbly. My Xbox controller's probably on its way out already. But you can see here, even if I just back up slightly, looking at these two weathered liveries, you can see that because of the different tender variations, there was, like, you know, 5,000 gallon, 5,100 gallon, 5,250 gallon, and 6,000 gallon tenders. So it mainly to do with the water capacity, but as you can probably see from this point here, you can see some difference in between these two types of tenders on the weathered one. So on the one on the left-hand side, you can see that it's got the slightly more modern cutout. It's got the slightly taller air pipes on the back, you know, the air canisters, and the tank itself is slightly taller. Whereas if you look at the one on the right hand side, you can still see the rave on top of the tender from when it was in its original condition. You can also see that the tank, the water tank, is slightly lower, so the side rave looks a bit different, and the air tanks are different as well. So, you know, I'm just looking at these, and, you know, the amount of variety that you get for a class of locomotive that was like this is, you know, it's fantastic. I know I'm probably going to sound like a broken record saying fantastic all the time, but, I mean, you look at the weathered variant, these things just look like, you know, you could run this on, there's a route actually, which is like Waterloo to Windsor and Eton and Surbiton in the 60s, and you could probably see that these would look quite at home on there. Must mention as well that these do come with a variety of scenarios. So if you've got all the requirements necessary from Bochman Games' list of things that you need for the scenarios, then go and have a go. I'm not really a scenario person, so I won't be driving the scenarios. I'll more than likely be doing my own boring thing, which is trundling these up and down preserved railways, because that's how sad I am. So you get the weather variant with the BR Green, and you've got the early and late tenders with it. And you can also choose to have it with or without nameplates. And you can also choose headboards and all this lot. Now, other features of the locomotive before I carry on onto the other liveries is it has performance mode in case you haven't got a decent enough PC to run them at full blast. Even me, I'm going to have performance mode with the Merchant Navy because of how detailed they are. You can also choose the performance category of the locomotive when you're running it in a scenario. So you've got a number between 5 and 1. 5 being, I think it's 5, which means pristine and it's going to run really well. All the way down to 1, where the locomotive struggles to make steam and is a bit of a pig to drive. Now that's a nice little feature. I don't really explore that very often, and it's on other Bochman Games locos, so I might have to explore that with the Merchant, especially if I'm running one, you know, in the condition that the one on the left is in, you know, no nameplates and, you know, heavily weathered. So overall, I've said about the BR liveries here that you can see, and these are all the ones that you would have used in everyday service in the with British Railways. Now we move on to some of the preserved liveries. So the one that I think everybody likes the most is probably this one. Now this is the livery that Canadian Pacific number 35005 once wore in preservation, and it is fictional. Yes, that's right. It has to be labelled as fictional BR lined blue, because the class were all rebuilt, as I said, during the mid-50s. When they were in their unrebuilt condition, or original condition, because the term unrebuilt doesn't really count, these would have all worn the Express Passenger Blue, or at least most of them wore the Express Passenger Blue in their original condition. Now, we haven't got a locomotive in the original condition, so the people who own Canadian Pacific painted it blue to see what it looked like. And I must admit, this is probably one of the best liveries in the pack. You can tell it's a preserved era livery as well because of the modern day warning flash stickers on it. And you can also see that I've put the golden arrow stuff on this one. So if we go in for a bit of a closer look, again, sorry about the camera work. You can see that it's a really nice livery. Still a bit iffed about the blurriness on some of the textures, but I'm pretty sure that we can forgive that if we're running this. And I'm pretty sure that Bochman probably had to make some sort of compromise in comparison to making the file size a decent size and able to make it downloadable without it taking up all your bandwidth. But, you know, we're looking here at 35005, and this is a fantastic livery for it. I don't care if it's fictional, it's lovely. I mean, look at that. You can also see that this one is actually the only variant you can run this with in Canadian Pacific's own tender, which is the 6,000 gallon variety, which was the highest amount of water in a Merchant Navy. And you can see that this one, if I just scoop up to the top of the tender, you can see that this one also has what I mean, this is what I love the most about the tender. It's this sort of like curved section at the top, the rave. I don't know why, I think it just makes it look a bit more, you know, stylish and unique. So I think of my of the liveries that are in the pack, I think this one's probably one of my favorite ones, and I'm gonna have to run my one with it at some point, because I do plan on having a Merchant Navy in my series at some point. Whether it's going to be owned by the Dark Railway or not, I don't know, but we're going to see. So, next up, we're going to scoot over the one in the middle, because we're going to go and have a look at the most famous member of the class, which is Clanline. Now, Clanline has a bit of a special, you know, configuration in preservation, because she has a special tender, and she also has dual braking, so she has air and vacuum, so she can run on all over the place. And as you can see, this one has the raves and things as well on the tender. But, you know, everybody and their mother knows about Clanline, because it's probably the best looked after locomotive in preservation. And I really respect it for that. I really respect the Merchant Navy Locomotive Preservation Society for looking after this thing. It's also quite famous because it's run on the main line every decade since it was built. So it's always been an operational locomotive, and it's always been a mainline locomotive. So it's got a lot of pedigree. And as you can see, there are some slight differences on the tender. One of the most famous things about Clanline, actually, is the fact that because of the equipment she has on board, she puffs smoke out of the back of her tender from time to time. And as you can see here, she's got those these grids here on the tender. That's something that's quite unique to this particular model of the tender. So you also get with the pack, just as a while we're talking about clan line, you also get a representation of her support coach, which I'm going to hopefully pronounce it correctly, is Mercator. But as you can see, this, like, Bossman has introduced, I don't know why I said introduced, Bossman has included the Merchant Navy Locomotive Preservation Society's support coach. I got it right. I have been getting it right all the time. Hooray. So, you know, we've got scenarios in the pack where you can run clan line as she does in real life. So that's absolutely fantastic. And, you know, if you're a fan of the, you know, Merchant Navy's or mainline running as well, you're going to really enjoy this pack. Especially just for the modelling side of things. Now, let's move on to something a bit controversial, shall we? So this is, it's supposed to be 35018, which in British India line. Now, when this was introduced back into service for test runs, this is the condition it ran in. It ran with its top number, which is 98818, and it ran with Carnforth's nameplates for Bodmin, which was a West Country class. Now, the reason this is funny is because the Bodmin is a rebuilt West Country as well. So people could mistake the rebuilt West Country for the rebuilt Merchant Navy because they look very similar from a distance. There's only very slight detail differences between a rebuilt Merchant and a rebuilt Light Pacific, but I think it was mainly to confuse everybody. And also the unique thing about this particular livery, apart from it being in unlined black, which is incredibly unprototypical but amazing, is the fact that on the smoke box number plate, you can see that Bossman have tried to replicate where they painted the number on to the smoke box. So, you know, if you kind of want to do a funny joke running around sort of, you know, job with this engine, you can. I'm also expecting reskinners such as my friend Edward, and possibly myself, and possibly people like Donington Reskins or Blast Pipe Productions. I don't know. Some people may get a kick out of putting this BR Black livery onto one of the normal merchants to see what it would have looked like with full lining or all of that lot. But, you know, for an engine configuration that only ran very briefly, Bossman Games have done a really good thing by including this livery in the pack because, you know, it would probably have just been one of those forgotten things, but to actually include it in as a bit of a sort of, I mean, a jokey reference, I suppose, or, you know, just to represent the class overall in its history, I think that's a really good thing for him to have done because it's such a quirky livery as well, and you don't really see many quirky liveries anymore. So seeing this is sort of really quite special, I must say. So there you go. That is looking at the variants and models of the Merchant Navies, and I think you will all agree that, apart from a few little things I've noticed, these are very good. One thing I will sort of come up to and talk about while I'm driving, before I drive it anyway, is something that kind of bothered me, and I should really message Bossman Games about it. He might watch the video, he might not. I'm not as popular as other YouTubers, so hopefully somebody else somewhere will point this out to him. Which is that in the cab, you can raise the roof vent when you're in the cab here. I'll show you when I'm driving it. But as you can see, on the external model of the locomotive, on top of the cab, there isn't that vent. And I thought that was slightly disappointing. The amount of work gone into all the other animations, it would have been nice to see the cab vent. There's also a few other things as well, like I just want to point out before I start driving this. I don't really like the sounds. This is just a personal thing, and it's not meant to be a knock at anybody, not Bossman Games, and not the Merchant Navy Locomotive Preservation Society, and everybody who helps record the sounds for it and all that. But I'm just not really a fan of the sounds. There isn't really that very prototypical tubular bell sound, I call it. I mean, I think it's a pretty commonly known sound. I'll have to try and get a sound recording of it at some point. But basically, with the Blue Pacifics, they all had this sort of really nice little sound when they're chuffing along, and it was sort of like, it sounded like a very musical sound. That seems to be lacking slightly, or at least is not very audible. And I think that's sort of a bit of a shame, to be quite honest, because it's a really nice sound. I'm also not a massive fan of smoke textures. I think some other developers have done better with the smoke textures of recent times, and it does tank my frames massively. But other than those small things, I don't want anybody to get the wrong impression. Overall, I think this is a really good pack. I might be slightly disappointed with some aspects of it, but Merchant Navies themselves, you know, they are incredible machines, and I'm really glad that Bossman have put them into TS. Now, that isn't to say, so I'm just trying to get the camera in the right place, That's not to say that this is going to be everybody's cup of tea. If you're a Southern Railway fan and you like the Merchant Navies, you're going to like this pack. Now, if you like driving advanced locomotives, I normally like driving advanced locomotives if there's a sort of given in between, you know, a bit of give and take. This to drive is going to be a bit difficult for some people. So if you're sort of hard of driving in train sim, I maybe wouldn't recommend it for you unless you're willing to put some time in to learn how a Merchant Navy works. So what we're going to do now is, to back up my claims of what I'm saying here, we're going to go over to the station, and if I can get my stupid camera to work, we are going to go and drive one of the Merchant Navies. So, which Merchant Navy do you guys think I would have for TDRF, do you think? Now, there's a lot of them, and there's a lot preserved, but I'm going for one that hasn't been preserved, and I'm going for one that's a bit special in my mind. So, ladies and gentlemen, for our test run today with the Merchant Navy Pacific, and to have a look at the cab of it, we're going to be using number 35015, Rotterdam Lloyd. Now, there's a reason I like Rotterdam Lloyd. For one thing, the main reason is that I can name it Lloyd. But secondly, my eventual to be father-in-law's name is Lloyd. So I think it's kind of a funny reference to him. So what we're going to be doing is we're going to have a look at the cab and the sounds of the rebuilt Merchant Navy. And then I'm going to take it for a quick drive. I'll also show you all the headboards as well in a moment. So if I click on it. So here we are in the cab. You can see that Bossman has modelled the cab very well. He's had lots of time to get reference pictures and actually has been to see the real life clan line to make sure that the cabs are very accurate. And I'll tell you what, as far as cab views go, this is probably one of the best ones, I'd say. Because you can see all the little details, you can see all the 3D name boards and things, you know, for all the different controls. If I just zoom in up here, you can see, like, you know, steam pressure, vacuum ejector, all these nice little things, the open and shut valves. You can really see that. That's really nice. You can also see, for example, the damper control there in the middle of the back head. You can see it's got open and shut written on it, and most of the valves have those written on. And that is something, actually, that Bully really tried to do. He tried to make the cab as ergonomic as possible so that it was easy to drive for the driver and the fireman. For example, you can see that we've got the brake ejector in front of us. Down here, we've got the reverser. And then up there, we've got the regulator handle. You've got all the valves up there and the pressure gauges that the driver would need to see. And on the other side, you'll see the fireman stuff. So if I move over there in a moment, you'll see, you know, the fireman controls there for the injectors and whatnot. You can tell this is a really well-modeled cab. Other things as well that are worth noting is the opening and closing windows. And as previously mentioned, the roof hatch. So unfortunately, that you can open it there, but it's not visible on the outside, so that's just my small criticism of the model. But then again, you have to have criticism to, you know, be a better person, I think, at the end of the day. I can't just go into everything and say that it's all amazing if I see something that I think is slightly wrong, or at least I don't really understand. So I hope that hasn't come across as me being too negative, but, you know, overall it's really nice. So what cab views do you get? It's not as extensive as Caledonia Works, I must say. It's all in the cab, and it's not as extensive as when Bossman Games tried to do it on his original Black 5, which is a real shame. I think more developers should do models more out of the cab. So we've got this one, which is the driver's side out of the cab. You've got the fireman's side out of the cab. You've got looking at all these different pipes and things, which I must admit are really well textured as well. And as we're on the fireman's side, you can see that the fireman's information is over here, like, you know, the boiler pressure and whatever that is. I think that's not the speedo, is it? Oh no, that's the pressure valve for something else. But then you've got up here where you can see the whistle valve there, and all the other little valves on top. I mean, look at the detail on these, it's lovely. And then we come back here, we can see an overview of the cab. We come down here and you'll see the firebox door, so I'm just going to open them. And now watch this, this is amazing because of the way the firebox doors on a Merchant Navy are. They're sort of latched. You know, they're ratcheted. You can, if I move the camera up, you can see the ratchets there. So overall, that is amazing. Then we've got the driver's side dials here. So you've got the speedometer, you've got the pressure gauge and the brake pressure gauge and the steam chest pressure there. And then back to here in front of that. So that's your cab view for you. That's the cab. This is probably one of the more pleasant cabs I've seen. And now I must point out as well something else for you drivers out there who maybe aren't as confident driving. If you flip that seat up there on that side, so if I do this, the automatic fireman will engage. So, there you go. The automatic fireman is now engaged, and I'll need him for my run because I'm not very good at firing. So while the fireman makes sure that we're ready to go, if we just click on the outside of the locomotive, we're going to have a look at the front end here. So as you can see, we've got number 35015. So what we've got here is you do control 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6, and you get all the head code lamps. I don't think there's a 7 yet. 7 does the reverse light there, but as you can see, you can basically set up your own head code and whatnot. You've also got the high intensity lamp with control 8, and I think control 9 is the reverse running light. You can also do the same thing on the back of the tender. As for the headboards, let's have a look. So if you do H and Shift H, you'll get the headboard. So first of all, you've got the golden arrow insignia, which includes the little arrows on the side of the smoke deflector and also the flags at the front. You've got the Knight Ferry. You've got the Royal Wessex headboard, the Bournemouth Bell headboard, probably my favourite one because I'm born in Bournemouth. You've got the Pines Express, so if you want to run over the S&D, you can. You've got the Fanet Bell for Kent area, so that's me again for DR. You've got the Man of Kent, which is obvious for the DR again. You've got the British Pullman, which is more for Clam Line. You've got the Cathedrals Express, which is pretty much everywhere. The Torbay Express, if you ever want to take them down to on the Riviera Line. You've also got the Waterloo Sunset, which is very appropriate. And the Devon Bell, so you can run the Devon Bell if you want over, you know, I can't even think, you can't take it over Southampton to Weymouth, can you? No, you'd have to drive it around Exeter then. Then you've got the Kentish Bell, which is obviously, again, a good appropriate place for the DR, which is why we're doing it on the DR today. And then we've got some more special headboards, which I'm going to have to zoom in for because of the lighting conditions. So these are the ones that were more special for the, shipping lines that the Merchant Navy were named after. Because they were, in a genius move by the Southern Railway, they were named after the merchant vessels, company lines that would have been running ships during the World War. So you've got the Statesman, that's for United States lines here, which is quite pleasant. The Union Castle Express for Union Castle. You've also got Greek Line, which is quite a funky looking headboard. Oriana, so that's the Peninsula and Oriental ones. You've also got the I'm going to pronounce it wrong. Thames Avon Express. You've got the Cumbrian Mountain Express, so that's very good for preservation era. The Strong Countryman. Yes, because we're entering the Strong Country. The Solent and Sarum, which I think is to do with like running along the South Coast. And then you've got the RLSB Orient Express. I'm not going to even try and work out what RLSB stands for, but I'm pretty sure someone in the comments will tell me. And then you've got the final one on the list. Clan Line, which you can obviously run with Clan Line. So as you can see, you can scroll right back through with them. Oh, I think I missed a couple. Yes, I did, look. We missed the Cunarder. We missed Holland America. I think we also missed another one, didn't we? Oh, the Canberra as well. So, you know, oh, and the Welsh Marches and the North something. You know, it's, oh God, North Wales Coast. You can basically put a headboard on this for any occasion. So, oh, the Brittany as well we missed. God, there's so many I missed out. I was only pressing it slowly. Anyway, so we've done enough sitting around at our station here. Should we have a listen to the whistles? Now, again, I'm not the most biggest fan of the whistle sounds and the chuffing sounds and all that on the Merchant. But they were recorded by the Merchant Navy Locomotive Preservation Society, I believe, on Clan Line. And they were probably recorded, I'm going to hazard a guess, by Bossman himself and possibly Chris Eden Green was involved. These are all conjecture. I'm not 100%. I'm not in the loop. But I can only assume from what my own information tells me that it's one of those sources. Somebody recorded sounds. Let's put it that way. So let's have a listen to the space sound. That sounds alright. You've got B key. Which also don't sound too bad. I thought there'd be more variety. There we go. And I think we've got another whistle on V. They're better. So anyway, shall we open up those cylinder cocks, get the brakes off, and we'll go for a short run. Now, I must admit, this is a difficult engine to drive, so forgive me if I do it all wrong. So I'm going to turn myself down, I'm going to turn the sounds up, and we're going to crack on with the Merchant Navy. Everyone, I think I will probably leave it there for this video because it's gone on for quite a long time now. So would I recommend the Merchant Navies? If you like Southern and would like Advanced, go for it. If you're a bit unconfident about it, maybe perhaps not, but overall I would say give this a thumbs up. So thank you everyone for watching, and I will see you all next time. Goodbye.